Divine Truth Assistance Group. These group assistance sessions are about putting principles of divine truth into action. This discussion is part of the 2014 Australia Group 1 series. Jesus presents forgiveness and repentance concepts. Filmed on the 15th of July 2014 in Monkerai, New South Wales, Australia. This is part 1.
Well, what I'm going to talk to you about now is to do with what I would classify as its relationship issues, but I'm going to call them forgiveness and repentance relationships. And I'm going to focus you firstly on the concepts of forgiveness and repentance, and secondly, I'm going to focus you on putting it into practice in your day-to-day life and what things you're going to have to be careful of if you're ever going to put it into practice. Does that make sense? So the first session will be all about the concepts and the second will be all about the practice. Now, if I can give you a little bit of background, firstly, in my 2,000 years of observation, I have not yet seen a person from the earth who understands these concepts. Right? Now, I began to understand these concepts around 15 years of age in the first century because I understood them through observation. I was observing the interrelationships in my family, my family's relationships with other families, and particularly where my mother grew up, which was around Nazareth. Obviously, there were extended family in that location, and you could see all of these interrelationships occurring. So it was a fascinating area to just observe and study, right? And what I observed through the process was that most people didn't actually have a logical interaction with any other person. What they did was they carried a whole heap of baggage into the interaction with the other person. And that coloured completely the interaction they had with this new individual. Does that make sense to you? And so when I observed what would be logical to have as an interaction, it never occurred. All that occurred was all of these addictive, facade-based interactions that were all driven by the past hurt that was unresolved within the individual. They drew the hurt into the next interaction. And nobody even knew they were doing that. They thought what they were doing was logical. But it was very illogical. It is very illogical. And that's what I have observed in every single person I've ever met from Earth. Every single person does that. They drag this old baggage into this new interaction. And then they say that the new interaction was, you know, a logical interaction. It cannot be, in fact. And then I started pondering how this needs to be repaired. What needs to be done to stop that from happening? Does that make sense? What actions, what things can we do to stop this problem that we keep pulling in our history into the next established communication we have with whomever? And that applies to the communication or the interactions we have with the environment. It applies to the interactions we have with each person. It applies to the interactions we have with our children. It applies to the interactions we have with spirits. They were dragging this baggage into every interaction. And that's when I started to realize the importance of repentance and forgiveness in our day-to-day life. And so what I would like to do is describe to you what happens in your relationships now and compare that with what would happen if there was no history baggage in these same relationships. Does that make sense? So let's do that, shall we? So here's you. Okay. Now, as you're growing up, who are the primary influences upon you? So, Eloisa?
Mum and dad, but also the environment, like, close friends.
With mum and dad. So here we go. Mum and dad.
That's if you've got a mum and dad, because, you know, if you're an orphan, it's going to probably be someone else, isn't
okay,
it?
So it'll be also members of your environment. So should we put just a circle around these? How well are you seeing red back there? Very...
Not particularly well.
Not particularly well. How about
you can
purple?
See it at the top, but not really at the back. Yep, that's pretty well. I'm okay with
that. So I'll just put up their parents. And then I'll draw other people. And we'll call them environment. Yeah. So they are the primary emphasis. Now, what? Yeah, say one more.
I don't know if they're included, but spirits, is that your environment or are they different?
Yes, I would include them. They're people.
All right, cool.
So let's conclude spirits. You see, too many times, too many of you at this point in time are still thinking of spirits as some special people.
Yeah.
No, they're just people. They just don't have this physical body. You just can't see them. That's the only difference. So they're still a part of your environment, right? Now, of course, we could extend that out even further, couldn't we? We could go into culture, like family tree, culture, society, government, religion. And all of those things do actually form a part of your formative years in your environment. And many of our damages come also from those entities. They're not a physical entity like one person, but they're a collection of people which all have an opinion or an idea. So can we have another set of people? Shall we draw them? Just another set of people. And what can we collectively call all of these people, do you think? Because they're groups of people now, aren't they? So let's put a sign around them and just call them groups. And those groups, right, those groups are form entities almost in their own right. So sometimes they are working groups where they do work. Sometimes they are religious, they are society, the government, professions, two Fs or one, yeah, one S, professions, and so forth, right? They form a formative part in our childhood years. So here we are, the child, and we're growing up in this large collection of people, individuals, all who have emotional injuries, and, you know, they all have a real self, a facade self, and a hurt self. Shall we say it like that? So they all have a collection of good things about them and things that are what we would classify as unloving or even downright evil. Right? A collection of all those things. Okay. Now, emotions start flowing into this child right from the moment the child is conceived. Now, of course, the mother is the primary carrier of the child from the time of conception to the time of birth. So whose primary feelings are going to start entering the child first, do you think? All right, makes sense? The mother? Yeah. So we first get an inflow of emotions, and I will use red under this circumstance, an inflow of emotions because we'll call it error or damage, which is in red, goes into the child from the mother during the gestation period, you know, while the mother's carrying the child. Of course, the father also has feelings, and they are, and if the mother is open to receiving those feelings, so that's a fairly big if, but if the mother is open to receiving those feelings, then those feelings can pass through the soul of the mother and into the soul of the child. Does that make sense? So the father's feelings flows through in that direction into the child, if the mother is open to those feelings. So, for example, if the mother in the society in the first century, the mothers generally had a fairly low opinion of themselves because they were taught from a very young age that the men were more important than women, right? And so that mother would have had a belief that she is a woman, so therefore she is of a lower stature than her husband. Does that make sense? And in the first century, that means that if this was a girl child, she would have automatically absorbed that lower opinion from her mother. And she'd be born with the idea or concept emotionally that she also, because she's a girl, is not as important as a boy. That just gives you one example of how that happens. Now, of course, while the child's in the womb, we also have the environment, and whatever the mother accepts as an emotion from the environment flows into the child. And we also have all these groups, and whatever the mother accepts as her belief systems from these groups, they all flow into the child. Does that make sense? Because the mother's soul is the only thing providing a protective barrier between the flow of emotion into her child. So all of these things flow into the child. Now, as mothers, can you start seeing how important it is that you deal with your emotional condition? It has a large effect on the child. By the time the child's born, all of these things have already happened. Right? So the child's born. The child is now outside of the soul of its mother. Right? The child now is starting to learn and develop itself. Now, all of these things that were flowing through the mother now flow into the child directly through the interactions the child has with the environment. You follow me? So now we've got the environment flowing into the child directly. We've got the groups that we mentioned flowing into the child directly, father's opinion flowing into the child directly, and, of course, still the mother's opinion, which the child would be most open to in its early formative years, will flow into the child directly. Can, again, you see, mothers, if you don't understand the truth and you don't believe it and you don't have emotional condition accepting the truth, then, of course, a lot of the errors of the children will be based around your errors. Yeah. So it's a fairly big responsibility, motherhood, right? Yeah. Okay, so now this child, what can we say is happening to this child? From the time of conception, it's getting emotional damage. We called that yesterday, what did we call that? The day before yesterday, sorry. We call it the hurt. So the child's receiving the hurt. Of course, its real self, the real self, is still there that God created, but now there's all this hurt being absorbed. And then on top of that, the mother has facades, the father has facades, society has facades, groups have facades. And so what's happening is all of these facades are also getting created from the time of conception onwards. So now there's also now a facade self being developed, is there not? Does that make sense? So here's the dynamic. Now, at this stage, where is most of this damaging part of ourselves coming from? So where is it coming from? So if we go up to Deidre.
From everyone else.
In other words, the child has not yet developed its will. You know, it's still a baby, right, at this point. So it's been born, but it's still a baby. It can't even choose to walk at this stage, right? So it can't even do something damaging to itself, really, without somebody else being involved in the damage. Does that make sense? Right. Now, the child learns to walk. Now what's starting to happen is the child is now starting to make choices and decisions. Initially, those choices and decisions are very unformed, aren't they? right? The child might be 1 year of age, learning to walk, and all it cares about is walking and picking up things and tasting them and smelling them and all of that kind of stuff, just developing some of the sensory apparatus the child is going to need in order to absorb the universe in which it lives, right? And so at this point, it's now starting to make decisions, but they're all very rudimentary decisions. They're all very basic decisions, and very few of them are emotional in their nature. But by the time the child gets to 2, 2.5, what's happening? The child's now starting to act upon some of its hurt and act upon some of its facade. What do we call that period nowadays on Earth? We call that the terrible twos, right? Most parents have heard of that. And the reason why we do that is because we know that by this stage, the child's now starting to have some formative development of its own will and is now quite largely responding still to the emotional hurt from its parents and the facade of its parents, and many times reflecting that facade back at the parents, right? In other words, the child is going through a process where it's trying to tell the parents from an emotional perspective what's wrong with the parents. And of course, most parents completely ignore that, right? Because there's nothing wrong with them, is there? It's always the child. You know, the child's screaming all the time. It's not our fault. The child's, you know, acting up all the time. The child's hitting other kids all the time. That's not our fault either. We're just nice, peaceful people, right? So we ignore it all. And the child acts out much of this data. Now, during this process, what's happening? The child is formulating its will and now starting to act upon its will. Does that make sense? So now the child's starting to pick up damage from where? From what source? Yeah, Deidre, again?
Now from itself.
From itself, right? So now there's a cycle of damage where it tries to do some damage in the environment. And of course, there is also this cycle where every bit of that damage comes back upon itself. Does that make sense? Okay. Now, by the time the child's 7, 8, 9, 10, and it depends a lot upon the force that the parents in particular have used upon the child as to when this change or transition occurs. By the time the child's up to 15, 16, 17, it's now trying to probably attempt to live a fair bit of its own life, right? But it just depends on what the parents do as to when that age will be. It'll be somewhere between the age of 5 or 6 to the age of 20. And for some people, it's the age of 40, right? Because they're still living at home and still haven't really gotten rid of a lot of the reliances on their parents. But it's a slow developing of their will, if you like. Okay, so that's the process. You know, I've talked about that process before a bit, right? So you know that process. How does all that relate to repentance and forgiveness? Well, let's go one step even further. Let's say now the child is now in its 20s. The child's now an adult. It's got its own work, its own job. It might even be married. It might even have children of its own now. And what does the child do? The child has a fairly formed will at this point, and the child is now acting out that will. So now the damage isn't all just going into the child anymore, right? So let's draw another set of flow of damage in a different colour. So we'll do this one as brown, right? I don't know if you can see it very good. No, you can't. So we might choose another colour if we can. Sorry, baby. If we can come up with a colour that's fairly bright but different to red. Yeah, I've got a purple. I want to use purple for notes. Sorry, guys. No, that's it, is there? No worries. I'll have to use one of these. I'll use black, eh? Just so now the black lines coming out of this child, who is now an adult, are what it does damage to. So now it starts doing some damage to the environment, If it has children of its own, so let's just draw some children of its own. So it has some children of its own. Down here, it starts doing damage to those children because of the choices that it's making out of harmony with love. It does usually damage to groups. Right? But what is, who and what is the primary amount of damage that it finishes up doing, do you think? Any ideas? If we go, if we go, just, I forget your name again, sorry. Nelly, that's right. If we go to Nelly, just about there with the mic behind you.
To itself?
Yes, it does, but that's not the primary problem. Right? If it was only damaging itself, it would be quite probably good in a way, but that's not what's happening. Right?
No.
So if we go to Teresa.
To its children.
To its children. That's where it's doing its primary damage, yes. And then where is it doing the rest of the main rest of the damage? Where is it doing that, do you think? Fab, if we come.
It's parents, isn't it?
No, most of the time most people won't damage their parents at all, actually. Yeah, did you know that? You might rebel against them, but you won't damage them. Mm. Why is that, do you think? Why is it that you don't do much damage to your parents? Any ideas? If we go to Luli, that there. And on this side, yep, so.
Because they've already got the injuries that you have that you would give back to them?
Correct. So you've already absorbed a lot of their injuries, so you already believe a lot of the things they believe. You already do a lot of the things they do. You already have the facade that they created. So, you know, it's highly unlikely that you'll do much damage to your parents, actually, for the rest of your life, right? The only time that you do some damage the rest of life is you go into a huge amount of rebellion and rage and then murder them or do something like that to them, you know, physically or emotionally, that is taking out your rebellion and rage on them, right? And that's obviously going to damage your soul, then you probably damage your parents. But aside from that, most of the time we don't even damage them at all. Okay. So who are the other groups that we wanted to go to? If we go to Louise over here.
Would it be their partner in the close relationships?
Yeah, so our close relationships. We can lump all that together. They're not our children, but we're talking about every other close relationship. So any relationship we have with a partner, any close friends that we have, all of those kind of relationships, shall we say. That's where the primary piece of damage is going to be. So let's draw another group of people here. Down here, I'm running out of space, but let's just leave them in there, like so, and we'll call those our relationships, and this person now starts harming the relationships. That's where that starts doing damage. Yep, John, just next.
What about if you are one of the older children? What about your younger brothers and sisters?
Well, most of the other, belief systems as an older child were developed by your parents. And so when you start damaging your younger brothers and sisters, then usually it's acting out the damage that your parents have already put upon you, right? So you could say in the long run that most of that damage actually comes from your parents rather than from you. Does that make sense? Yep. Felix?
What if I was a teenager, though, at the time, and I had more free will than...
Of course, then you're starting to do it. But even then, a lot of it was done because you're already predisposed to act that way towards them because your parents probably allowed it in your younger time, in your younger life, or created the dynamic in your younger life. So even a lot of that is partially the responsibility of the parents. Not fully, of course, because you're developing your will. So anything that you act out of harmony with your will is going to be attributable to you.
Okay. I'm thinking about my little sister, who has Down syndrome and some autism. Yeah.
Yeah, for a person who has Downs or autism or something like that, then she is mostly acting out the feelings of her parents.
Yeah.
right? So she is still like an undeveloped child, and so therefore she is really spending most of her time just acting out the damage of her parents. Yep. Okay. Now, we've got a whole lot of red streams here, so let's put the red up here and let's make a legend, shall we? So that's the damage to self. And let's put the black legend up, as the arrows, black arrows are the damage to others. Now, of course, it's not just people we can damage, is it? God, the way God's created the universe is God, because God made us as the highest of all God's creations, that meant that God automatically placed us in a position of domination, potentially, over the other of God's creations. Now, of course, if we loved, we probably wouldn't dominate those creations, but unfortunately, we don't love, and so what we finish up doing is a lot of power-based damage to the other parts of God's creation. And all of that is also damage coming that's going to enter our soul. So there's damage that we also do to the environment that hasn't got people in it. Does that make sense? And there's a huge amount of that goes on this planet, isn't there? Huge amount. Most of us are totally unaware of how much, actually. Most of us come to a pristine environment, what we think is a pristine environment. So, oh, this is so beautiful. And yet if you could see it 400, 500, 600 years ago, you wouldn't say it's that beautiful now. You would say, oh, this is pretty damaged. Right? Because we have time. We only have a snapshot of 70 or 80 years on this earth, right? And so in that time, we can't measure the full extent of the choices we have made. That's a fact. So let's go to Joy down the front.
Wouldn't the damage that my children do to the environment have come through from the parents'
Well, it depends what age, doesn't it? If they did damage to the environment when they were 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, then yes, of course, all of that damage probably comes from your ideas or concepts. But if they're doing damage when they're 35, well, now how much of it is attributable to the use of their will and their lack of self-reflection and their lack of honesty with themselves and all of these other lacks that they've developed within themselves over their life, and how much of it is attributable to you? Well, obviously, it's a sliding scale down, isn't it? The older the child gets and the more removed it becomes from its parents, the less influential its parents become on the child, and so therefore the child's actions are more attributable to themselves. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so even if I've taught them something that's really unloving to others or to the environment,
yes,
ultimately they're using their own free will to make their own choices.
Eventually, yes. Eventually. They are using their own free will to make their own choices. This is why I keep saying to you, you can't blame your parents for everything you've chosen to do, because I've seen people who've been abused not abuse other people, not try to hurt other people. I know plenty of people in the spirit world who have been terribly abused when they're on earth, and now they don't do any abuse whatsoever. They're all loving with everybody. So that's the exercise of their will. And we remember on Saturday it was, when Mary did her talk, I emphasised to you afterwards the point of the will, how powerful it is. It's more powerful than anything you can imagine. It's far more powerful than any damage you have. Right? So you can undo any damage you have through the exercise of your will in a certain direction. Matthew.
So I'd really then want to, if I was sincere, I want to be focusing on a lot of my behaviour, especially since becoming an adult, like a late teenager and into my adult years, and all of those like close relationships and relationships with my children and stuff that I've had.
Correct. It's very powerful to do that.
That's what I've got the most resistance to doing.
Exactly. And that's what everybody has most resistance to doing, as you'll see from as we go through this discussion. You know, it's not... As you saw already in the 3 days that we've already presented, what were your most resistive talks? the facade self, which is very adult, and all of your addictions, which are very adult, right? So what does that tell you? Mostly, we don't want to come to terms with what we have done to others when we have had the choice to do something different. We don't want to do that. And most of our soul damage is caused by the choices we make and what we've done to others. Right? Now, I gave a talk many years ago, I think 6 years ago now, and I listed the order in which most of us process emotionally. And the very last things that we do generally is look at what we did to others. In my opinion, it should be the first thing we look at, but it's usually the last thing we look at. Right? We have a very much a victim mentality where we only look at what others did to us and think it's terrible, it's shocking, it's so bad. But we don't look at what we do to others. So in our legend now, the brown, I know it's not very clear, but we can call that damage to self, right, still. But it's a special type of damage to self based on the upon non-soul-based creatures. Can we call them that? Non-soul-based creatures. So in other words, I do damage to the environment. There is a penalty on the soul for doing that, on my soul, but there's no not necessarily a penalty on somebody else's soul. That's not always the case, of course, because you can do damage to the environment and stop 100,000 people from eating. And that's going to cause some damage to you too, right? Because now it's affected the human souls of other people. So some damage to the environment is so extreme that there's a huge penalty upon the soul as a result of the choices that you've made to do it. Because it affects so many other people and their souls and causes them pain and causes them suffering. And it was a direct choice of your will. So, of course, it's going to cause damage to your own soul. Okay. So we've got a bit of an idea of where all the damage is coming from. All right. And as we've seen over the last few days, we're quite okay looking at the real self in the sense, and when I say quite okay, most of us have got no awareness of our real self, but we like to hear about it. When it comes to our hurt self, most of us are very, what I would classify as self-absorbed and narcissistic, and so what we finish up doing is saying, yes, I was hurt. Once we admit to ourselves we were hurt, we go, yes, I was hurt, and yeah, everyone else was terrible to me and I was terrible, but I'm innocent. Right? And then there's also the fact that generally parents blame children, which is an issue, isn't it? Usually parents blame children for the way the parents treated the children. And so then the child finishes up growing up believing that it deserves to be hurt when the reality is it didn't deserve it. So we have a lot of dynamics that are quite difficult to unravel. But that's the general scheme of things in terms of how things happen in terms of our environment. Now what I'm going to do is talk to you about the relationship side of that specifically. Because remember, any soul-to-soul interaction is a relationship. Even if you hate someone, you are actually having a relationship with them. Do you get that? Even if you hate them, you are having a relationship with them. Right? The reason why you're having a relationship is an emotion inside of you is flowing out of you into that person. And there might be a corresponding emotion coming out of them towards you, but that is a relationship. From God's perspective, the flow of emotion between two people is the relationship. Right? So now I'm talking about all those people with whom you have a flow of emotion with. A flow of a feeling between you and another. Right? We come down to...
Is it true to say that we've got the strongest connection with someone we resent because when we resent someone, we think about them and it produces more of a resentment is a tie to someone?
Can I talk about one of your addictions just briefly? You want to make a whole rule for everything. can't you just let my statement be? We have a relationship with everyone, and some of your relationships, the most powerful, are love-based relationships, I feel. But there are very powerful hate-based relationships too, because that's all almost the complete opposite. It's evil that's being transmitted between the two. So, of course, they are strong relationships, but I wouldn't classify them necessarily as the strongest. Okay. Why would you believe they're the strongest?
Just because I felt that a love, when you more of a, when you like someone or you have good feelings about them, it doesn't, you don't think about them or put energy into them, whereas when you resent...
What did you just say? You say it again.
When you like...
When you love someone...
Not love
a partner.
No, this
is what you said. When you love someone, you don't really put that much energy into them. What?
Yeah.
I suggest you've never loved anybody, Laura, if that's the way you feel. Do you understand? The person that you love, you put the most energy into, in fact. Right? So I would strongly consider whether you've ever loved anybody making a statement like that. The reality is most of us are driven by fear, right? We are. And so we put most of our energy into fear-based relationships. We do. But the reality, all that does is prove that we've never loved anybody. Because when you truly love someone, that's where all of your energy, a majority of your energy goes. Nowhere else. When you truly love someone, that's where it goes. So I would never say a comment like you've just made.
I did kind of mean when you like people, like friends, not a love of a partner. Like,
no, you didn't. You said what your soul feels.
Okay.
Allow it to be. You said that what the statement you made was that you don't put much energy into love-based relationships, and the reality is you don't. If you look at your day-to-day life, you don't. You spend most of your time worrying and concerned about the people who don't like you.
Yeah.
You don't put most of your time into being worried or concerned about the people who do like you. Right?
That's true.
That's true, isn't it? So what your statement was a statement of truth about yourself, but it's also a statement of truth about the fact that you've never really loved. Because if you really love, you wouldn't do that. You wouldn't put all your energy in someone you don't like. You put all your energy in someone you do. Why do we put all of our energy into someone we don't like? Because we want their approval to get them back into liking us. And then when they like us again, where does our energy go? Oh, not to them anymore, because they already like us. We don't have to worry about them. Now, that's not what you do when you love. That's called a codependent barter. That's just that's totally different to love. When you love, you put huge amounts of energy into that person. That's where your primary focus is. And that's the way it is. It's always going to be that way. The majority of us don't love. The majority of us are concerned about all the things where people don't like us or people are upset with us or they don't approve of us or all those kind of things. And as a result, we finish up putting all of our energy there. Yep.
Yep.
Okay. Can I state that sometimes in questions that I get, there is so much error in the question that it would take me an hour to answer the question. Like what we've been finding in our frequently asked questions is that there's so much error in the actual premise of the question that we've got to undo all the errors of the assumptions that are made in the actual question before I can actually answer the question. And this is because most of us have no idea what the truth is about love or any other thing. And so we're asking questions based upon our facade, our addictions, all of the hurt and errors inside of us, rather than asking even very clear questions. And the main reason why we do that is because we are unable to have clarity about love in our current condition. So people laugh at me when I have to give an hour answer for what seemed to be a very simple question. But sometimes what else can I do? I've got to undo all of the unloving premises and undo all of the untruth in the question itself. And then once I've done that, then I can answer the question. So you'll find that's happening a lot on our Frequently Asked Questions channel, isn't it, darling? So So one question we think, oh, that could be a two-minute answer for that one, yes or no. Sometimes I go, oh, this question's got so many bad assumptions in it. I've got to address all of them before I can say the answer to the question is yes. Yeah. Okay, so here we are. We've now, so let's draw ourselves. We'll still choose ourselves. Okay. So now we're dealing specifically with relationships, okay? So now we're focusing on relationships. There is the relationship we have with the two people who have primarily influenced our life, particularly if we've lived with them most of our formative years, our parents. And then there's the relationship we have with when the children that we may have had. So this one is parents. This one is children. Okay. Then there's the relationships which are our primary relationships. And so if we look at that, that's going to be our partners nowadays, more than partner, isn't it? And then it's going to be our friendships. I probably shouldn't draw the partner in black. Nobody else is, so let's draw the partner in blue. And then it's our friendships, of which we will have both male and female friendships, most probably, depending on the damage that we've had from our parents. So there's the group of people as well which we have a relationship with. So there's also that group. So they are, so I'll just write upon them, just rub that out actually because I need my space. I write on them. So they are our, let's call them our friends and acquaintances. Acquaintances, and this is our partner, and of course it will also mean our previous partners if we've had some, and our children. They're the people we primarily have a relationship with, acquaintances, friends. So this would also nowadays include things like work, colleague. How do you spell colleague? Let's simplify it for me. Workmates. Okay. Friends, acquaintances, the kind of people we spend a bit of time with. Yep. Glenn, up the back there.
So if we don't have children, is that an actual benefit? Does that make sense?
Well, let's have a look at what's going on, shall we?
Yep.
Okay. Isn't it true from our previous diagram we can see that there's been damage that's primarily come in this group of people? Where has the primary damage come from in all that group of people? Primary damage has come from, Sherry? For you.
Our mother?
It's really our mother and father, isn't it? But initially it's been our mother for the first 9 months, hasn't it? Because it's come through her. But it doesn't necessarily mean it comes from her. It's gone through her. So if she's been open to that damage, then it's gone through her, but also from her. So we've got damage that's gone initially in that direction, but now primarily we've got the damage from there, and because we've grown up probably with dad as well, damage from there. That's the primary damage entering into our soul, is it not? And what's the primary damage going out of our soul? Remember that was in black. So we were going to draw that in black. If we come down to Diane, just down front. If you keep your hand up, Diane, just, that's it.
Children?
Our children? So a primary damage coming out of our soul is towards our children, isn't it? Okay, so that's coming out of our soul primarily. And the secondary damage that comes out of our soul is towards?
To our partners and our...
Yeah, so you could say there's an order of importance, basically, isn't it? It depends on how much time you spend with each individual, of course, and what you do to them. But primarily it's going to be next the partners and then next the workmates, acquaintances, friends and so forth, isn't it? And then if we can get further away, then there's like society, culture, government, religion, and that's all on the periphery, if you like, isn't it, of the kind of damage that we're doing. Yeah. And then you could also say there's environment, which is non-soul damage to the environment, but it's a soul damage in reflection back to yourself. So there's also that. Okay, so have you got, you've got the flow of damage. You got all that fine? Okay. So if I then introduced you to a concept which said, who do we forgive and who do we repent towards, can you see that it's quite clear from the diagram who we need to forgive and who we need to repent towards? Can you see that? The people we need to forgive will be the people who did the damage to us primarily. Now, they are primarily our mother and father in this diagram, are they not? Right? Now, of course, if we grew up in an orphanage, then it's the orphanage. If we grew up in a household where there was grandma bringing us up, then it's grandma. If, do you see what I'm saying? Or a mixture of mum and grandma if there was no father around. It just depends on who was the primary caregiver to the child. So you can work all that out in your own life, who was your primary caregiver throughout your childhood. And, of course, you could also say, nowadays in modern society, so this is very much what society has been for many thousands of years, but let's add another group of people, shall we? Because they have us from a very young age nowadays. And that's the group of people who are, again, probably mostly women in modern society, in Western society, but shall we call them our teachers and caregivers? And, of course, there will be some damage, won't there, coming from them into us. Right, so if you went to, like, if you were in an orphanage, it would be the people who managed the orphanage. If you went to a boarding school when you were five, then it would be the teachers and the boarding school principal and all those people, group of people who managed the process of looking after you from the time of five onwards. And it just depends for each person what the underlying source of the damage will be. But the red ones, remember, they are the damage coming into you, and the black ones are the damage coming out of you. Right? Now, bearing all that in mind, the persons to forgive would be the red ones. Okay, so red are the people that we need to forgive. So ever see that? If we trace that back to the source, that's the persons we're going to have to forgive at some point, right? So that's that person there, this group of people here. They're the people we're primarily going to have to focus on forgiving. Does everyone get that? And the people that we're going to have to primarily focus on repenting towards are the people who are the start, the end of the arrow, right, towards the damage that we've done. So that means our partner, our friends, acquaintances and workmates, and in particular our children. They are the people that we're going to have to repent towards because of the damage we did to them. So you follow me so far? Yeah? Okay. Now, do you know what I notice? Most of you try to forgive the people you need to repent towards, and you try to repent towards the people you need to forgive. And you know, if you do that, you won't process anything. Did you get what I just said? You repent towards the people you need to forgive, and you forgive towards the people you need to repent towards. And of course, all of that is based on falsehood. It's all based on false information that causes us to try or attempt to do those things. So, for example, I've known of some, what you would call them, I suppose, pseudo-spiritual development programs that tell you that you were a mongrel to your parents, that you were terrible to your parents. You're the one who, you know, you need to repent for all the things you did wrong to your parents. Right? Now, I'm not saying that you didn't do any damage to your parents, because, of course, any time you acted out of harmony with love, you sinned. And if you acted out of harmony with love to your parents, then you sinned against your parents, as well as towards God, of course, because your parents are another child of God, and you just damaged another child of God. Right? But most of our relationships, our physical relationships that we're having at the moment, are based around this dynamic. Now, let's introduce a few additional factors which we didn't introduce, and that is we're attempting to have a relationship with God, right? Now, did God do any damage to us? No. And did we do any damage to God? Yes. We attempted to. How can I say yes? What's the answer there? Celia, that's right.
When we damage others, we are damaging God.
Good. So that's one time when we're damaging God. When I damage one of God's children, I'm basically damaging God, aren't I? I'm trying to anyway. I'm acting out something towards God that God wouldn't want me to act out. So I am attempting to, you could say. It doesn't mean God receives it. I'm attempting to damage God when I do that. What's another time when I attempt to damage God? If we go to Alan.
I denied for many years to my children and others that there was God to even have a relationship.
Right. So you, through your belief systems, told the people you had some kind of influence over that there was no God, or that it was impossible to have a relationship with God, and that, of course, interfered with God's relationship with those people. Does that make sense? Is there another way we also damage God, or we attempt to? Because it doesn't enter God, of course, but is there another way? Okay, if we can.
When we are angry towards God or have damaging emotions towards God, like even though God doesn't receive them, because it is our intention, like our choice.
Yes.
And if he was to receive them, you know, it's our intention, even though he doesn't.
Our intention is to harm God, isn't it? So you could say there is an attempt there to damage God. Yes. So there's another attempt that we've made. Of course, like we say, we can't enter God because God doesn't allow any of these things to enter him. If we come back down to date.
Whenever we're rebelling against God or God's laws, basically, we're just...
Yes, we're trying to break... Anytime we're trying to break God's laws, we're always attempting to flaunt, you know, rebel against God. Of course, God just goes, what are you trying to rebel against? Like, I'm the most powerful being in the universe. Do you really think you're going to be able to rebel? But you know, that's what we're attempting, yes? When else? And if we go across to...
Even just denial that God exists.
Denial of God's existence? Yes, interferes with our potential relationship with God. Denise? Straight back there, that's good.
When we damage any of God's creation?
Yes, when we damage all of God's creations. We are really saying to God, well, stuff you, I'm going to damage all your creations without any thought about it, you know. So we're also doing that. Of course, none of that enters God. So God doesn't incur any soul damage for the damage we created. However, you do. So every time you attempt to do that, you actually do some damage to yourself, and many times you also do damage to other people from that attempt. For example, whenever you deny God and you get up in front of 100,000 people and you tell them that they shouldn't believe in a God, and you write a book about not believing in God, and you write, you're damaging their relationship with God. So you are being influential, and of course there's going to be some soul damage on your own soul. This is the thing with the damage towards God, is it doesn't enter God, but it certainly does enter you. But again, it comes from your choices, so it's a choice you made that you will need to repent for. Does that make sense?
I have a question. What about if you, I'm thinking of my children in particular, you tell them about God,
yeah,
but you act very out of harmony,
yeah,
with God's laws. So in other words, you're telling them there's a God and you're trying to demonstrate it, and yet you as a parent are being completely hypocritical.
Yeah. Well, of course that's going to damage your children and their relationship with God.
Right.
Yeah,
right.
Of course. So every time you're hypocritical, of course that's the case. Every time you're in facade with another person, you're actually damaging you, and you're damaging your relationship with that person, and therefore there's going to be some soul damage upon you as a result. So did you know that? Every time you're in your facade, there's some damage on your soul. Every time you act out in facade, when you deny the truth of your true nature and you interact like that with another person, you're presenting a facade to them, you're actually damaging them. They can't have a relationship with you. You can't have a relationship with them, but you're actually incurring soul damage while you do it. Same goes every time you feed one of your addictions. You're harming your own self. You're harming your own body. You're harming your own life most of the time. And most of the time you're trying to harm somebody else in the process because you're trying to suck something from them that, or demand something from them that, or coerce something out of them that they didn't want to give. And so most of the time, not only are you damaging them, but you're also now damaging you. And this is a problem for many of you. You're not seeing your addictions like that. You think your facade is just a fun facade that you put on everything, you know, or your addictions are just a great way to get happy. But it's not like that at all. It's much more serious than that from God's perspective, right? Helen?
Doing the homework last night, I think was an exciting, you know, understanding, which was I looked at why I wanted my addiction, and I looked at all the things that my hurt self was.
Yeah.
And then I realised everything I wanted to fix was about that, you know, about that.
Yes.
And then I realised that, let me just think of it, because it was convoluted, but I realised in trying to help my, you know, protect my hurt self, I was actually making the people around me have the damage that I was doing, like, you know, the so if I wanted to feel superior, then I was actually making them feel superior by trying to feed my addiction. And then I think that's what I thought.
Then
I realized that the other thing was that this was particularly about, you know, wanting to be right, and then realizing how that extrapolated out into the whole environment, like, you know, yeah, because I wanted to be right. I was willing to have that thing feeling, damage other people and yep, damage the all of the rest of the environment. That's yep, pretty not very clear, but that was the understanding I got of that process of what the hurt soul did. Yeah,
correct.
So it was exciting for me.
It's very exciting to come to that realization. And in fact, this is one of the things that we're going to have a look at in a minute. That many of your addictions are the direct result of your refusal to forgive or repent. In fact, almost every one of your addictions are the direct result of your refusal to forgive or repent. So that's a very important thing that we're going to discuss with you. So what I'm going to do now is get Fab to just go to the next slide, and let's just go through the first things. Yeah, you just need to skip through a few pages, actually. Yeah. So we've revised a lot of this stuff already. So let's get... Yep. Here we go. So this is the first thing I would like to say to you both, to all of you. This is 2 points here. Almost all of your own and the world's suffering comes from two things. It comes from your refusal to forgive, or it comes from the refusal to repent. You see, if you had forgiven, then you wouldn't have taken actions probably anymore that were based upon the things you've forgiven. So, for example, if your parents treated you badly and you felt really low worth, and then you decided that you were going to try to feel superior, so what you did is you treated your children in a manner that made them feel like they are superior, right? That then caused damage to the world. They then think they're superior to other people in the world. So what happened if you had actually forgiven your parents for them feeling superior to you? What would have happened? You would have felt that you're just as equal to anybody else in the world as anybody else, and so you wouldn't have taught your children that they are superior. You would have taught your children that they are equal. So then there would have been no damage. Every little bit of pain and suffering that you experience right now comes from these two particular problems, the refusal to repent and the refusal to forgive. That's how important it is. Every facade you've created comes from the refusal to repent and refusal to forgive. Every single addiction you have right now comes from the refusal to repent and the refusal to forgive. So once I realized this in the first century, what do you think I did? Thanks, Eloisa.
I reckon you gave it a go.
Yeah, that's exactly right. I said, I don't really have to worry about anything else. All I need to do is learn how to forgive and learn how to repent. That's all I have to do. And if I learn those two things the best possible way that I can, I'll get close to God more rapidly than any other way. But to do that, you have to give up your facade, and you have to give up your addictions, and you have to do all these other things, right? That's the issue. But I realize that this needed to become my focus. So what that meant was that I decided to focus on forgiveness and repentance in my personal development. Does that make sense to everyone? And you can make the same choice. Remember, on Saturday, Mary said to you, are you going to make the choice to love or not? Right? How are you using your will? You can use your will to make this choice, to make the choice to become more loving. And how do you become more loving? You just, instead of refusing to repent and forgive, you choose to repent and forgive. That's how you become more loving. And there's a process involved, which we want to talk to you about, of course. When I say a process, there's emotions that are going to be involved, because this is all soul-based work. It's not something you're going to be able to go, oh, I forgive you, oh, I forgive you, oh, I forgive you, and it's all done. It's not like that at all, because it's based on what is the reality of your feeling inside of your soul. Do you feel like forgiving them? No. Do you feel angry at them? Yes. So that's not forgiving them, right? You need to go through these feelings into the hurt and actually go through a lot of emotions in order to forgive or repent. But it is the most rapid way of processing through your unhealed self, your hurt self. It's the most rapid way to let go of all of your addictions. Because all of your addictions have been created to avoid doing these two things. All right? These two things are related to your hurt self. And whenever you choose to avoid doing them, you're going to be in your facade self, you're going to be in your addictions. A lot of your addictions will automatically disappear when you do this. That's hopeful, isn't it? Because you were freaked out about having to go through every one of them one by one, weren't you? Yeah, you were. And you were freaked out about having to deconstruct that facade in the manner that I was talking to you about, which you're going to have to do, but this is the, if you could think of it, it's the fast way to get into a lot of these things. Now, the only problem with it is, though, you can't repent for something that you have to forgive, and you can't forgive something that you have to repent for. And also, you can't do it in your head. So you can't do this intellectually. It's impossible, in fact. And in addition to that, the problem with it all is that if we don't do these things, we're going to have the law of compensation acting upon us all the time to try to help us get to do these things. So repentance and forgiveness is a major part of the way to God. It is, in fact, a large part of the way. Do you understand why? Because the law of compensation is the other way. Now, do you know the difference between the two laws? The law of compensation is basically saying this. You do something wrong. You resist all the reasons why you did it. You don't even try to think about it. You're in denial about it. And the law, compensation, is going to place some damage in your soul, and then it's going to act upon that damage in the soul with pain and suffering inside of your soul, and it's going to keep doing that until you admit you did something wrong. In fact, what it's going to do is it's going to keep doing that until you engage the higher law, which is repentance. So it will act upon your soul, triggering you every single moment of every single day, just prodding, 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 prodding and prodding and prodding more, prodding, prodding, and still prodding, right? Waiting for you to come to the realization that you have actually done something wrong and you can repent for it. Now, the law of compensation also acts upon your refusal to forgive. Because when you refuse to forgive, you're angry, you're resentful, you do a whole heap of things to damage other people because you're refusing to forgive a group of people. We'll go through this in a minute. And so what happens? The law of compensation is prod, 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 prod again with regard to why aren't you forgiving this person? Why aren't you forgiving this person? Why aren't you forgiving this person? And your refusal to forgive means that pain and suffering is going to be in your soul until you forgive. Now, if that's 100 years, it's 100 years. If it's 1,000 years, it's 1,000 years. There's people 2,000, 5,000 years still haven't forgiven. It's kind of law of compensation, causing pain in the soul until such a time as a person comes to realize that they've actually done the wrong thing by not forgiving. See, most of you feel justified in not forgiving, if you think about it. All the people have harmed you, you go, yeah, they harmed me. You know, there's this anger and resentment inside, and there's a refusal to forgive them. And that forgiveness is not just a simple, oh, I forgive you. I'm so magnanimous or whatever the word is. Aren't I so wonderful? I've forgiven you. I've forgiven you. It's not a fiction, a facade. It's an actual state you're going to have to go into emotionally where you have no animosity towards that person at all inside of your heart, where you have no feelings of wanting to harm them or hurt them and no feelings of resentment. All of those feelings have all gone because you've gone through this process of forgiveness. Does it make sense? Yeah. So the suffering, not only your personal suffering, or like your physical suffering, your body, what's happening to your body, the fact that you grow old and die, all of these things are all caused by these two causes, actually. Your refusal to forgive and your refusal to repent. And none of you understand that yet. But there will be a time when you start engaging these laws and you see an improvement, a rapid improvement in yourself, and then you'll start realizing, this is one of the secrets about God's way. This is one of the secrets about engaging God's path. Instead of just hammering away at the law of compensation every day, or you could say more truthfully, the law of compensation hammering away at you all day, you have a choice, and if you loved, you would make this choice to actually go through these processes instead. Even if you loved yourself, you would make that choice, let alone if you loved anyone else. Because it's an easier road and also far more sincere and truthful than the other road. So, of course, you'd make the choice. But most of us don't make that choice. Celia?
And when we do choose to forgive or repent, does that help to say we choose to forgive? Does that help the person also, their soul, that we're forgiving?
It can.
Yep. And because, the same with repentance.
Because before the time we forgive, we're judging. And what is judgment? When you feel judged, what do you feel like dealing with any emotion when you're judged? You don't, do
no,
you?
No.
Like when you're judged, you just go, oh, you know, you feel like fighting the judgment, don't you? You don't feel like actually dealing with the emotion underneath, the hurt. And this is a problem, is you see, when we refuse to forgive, we've got all this judgment coming out of us, all this resistance coming out of us. And as a result of all this stuff coming out of us, what's going into the other person is all this judgment and resistance and everything. And, of course, that's making it more difficult for them to even admit that they did something wrong, right? In other words, it makes it more difficult for them to repent. So when we refuse to forgive someone, it makes it more difficult for them to repent. It doesn't mean that we're responsible, though, for their lack of repentance. God doesn't make you responsible for the fact that you haven't forgiven your parents, for example, right? But it does have an effect on them. So when you do forgive them and it's sincere, they will feel it. And when they feel it, things change between you and them. Automatically starts changing. Initially, they might get really angry because that's one of the first responses generally of a person coming closer to their emotions. That things in a relationship will change generally if you forgive somebody. It's not always the case, but it can be the case. Paul, if we just straight to Paul.
With our kids, is repentance pretty closely connected to feeling guilt?
No. Guilt is an emotion that is actually what I classify as a self-absorbed narcissistic emotion, because it prevents you from seeing the real damage that you've done. It's really a feeling sorry for yourself, guilt, a lot of the times. True repentance is an acknowledgement, and we will actually have to at some point in the future go through what repentance actually looks like. But first, you've got to see that it's an acknowledgement of the actual truth. And the actual truth is you're not hurt, they are. Right? You did the hurting. When you have to repent, you have to come to acknowledge that you did the hurting. Now, that's not a self-absorbed place of feeling all guilty and self-focused and narcissistic. That's a place of seeing what you did to the other person. That's a place of reflecting upon the damage that was done to them, how they have now responded in their life because of what you did. That's a very different place than guilt. Does that make sense?
Well, I wonder whether emotions which I've been feeling towards my kids have been repentance, or if they've been more guilt.
Yeah. Well, if you think about some of the emotions that you've had, certainly they've been more guilt-driven than repentance-driven. Does that make sense? Usually a person who's in guilt-driven finishes up doing even more damage to the child than less, because they become very narcissistic and self-absorbed about the damage they did In other words, they go, oh, isn't it terrible? And this is where you see parents often going to the child and saying, oh, I need you to forgive me for what I did to you. And if you don't forgive me, I don't know what I'll be able to do. What did you just do? What did you just do? You just made them responsible for the rest of your life. And that actually is another sin that you've just committed against them in your process of what you called repentance. That's not repentance, right? True repentance is felt in your heart and doesn't have to engage the individual in any discussion. Right? True repentance comes from your soul. It doesn't come from your desire to have them forgive you. The reality is the amount of damage we've done to our children, they could forgive it, not forgive us for 100 years and we'd deserve it. Right? But what I'm telling you, talking to you about here, the two, if you like, the fast way, which is the divine love way of going through your emotions. Right? What we've talked to you up until now, you're still going to have to engage because that's the natural love way of dealing with things that you don't get to this place with. You see, the whole reason why we've talked to you about all the other 3 days is because we wanted you to come to terms with the fact that you've done something wrong. You've committed sins. You've done something out of harmony with love. We need you to see it, because if you don't see it, you'll never get this way. Because the starting point of this way is to see what's been done and what you did. In truth, see what's been done and what you did. Does that make sense? You can't start to repent if you don't think anything was done to you, and you can't, towards others from you, and you can't start to forgive if you don't think anything's been done to you. Alan?
The other part of the understanding that I had, which was the really exciting part, I think, was I looked at why is it a sin what I've been doing with my addiction? And I was reading the prayer and I saw the sacrifice, not having to, you know, sacrifice any of your creatures. And I realized the sin is that I have sacrificed everybody around me and the environment and stuff, and feeding my addictions. Correct. So that's that sacrifice.
Correct.
Yeah.
Correct. Yep. So you then start to see what you've done.
Yeah.
You see, there needs to be an awareness of what you've done.
Yeah. And it just gave me an incy little bit of emotional.
Yeah.
You know.
Of course. Yeah. And then there also needs to be an awareness of what others really did to you. Now, I see many of you having a large trouble with that. Because when I start talking about what your parents did to you, you go, oh, it wasn't that bad. No, I don't think it was like that. No, it wasn't that. You know, it didn't have that a large effect on me. If you could see what happened to your soul as a picture while it was happening, you wouldn't say any of those things, right? But most of us go, oh, it's not that bad. And why do we go like that? Because we've been taught to go like that because of the addictions or the facade of our parents entered us while we were still young. And so we grew up becoming, having the same opinions and the same concepts as our parents. So if they felt we deserved it, what do we go around saying as an adult? Yeah, I got belted a few times by my mum and dad, but I deserved it. But if I belted you right now, I'd be in jail for assault. Even if you deserved it. Right? Can you see what we do? It's okay for the kid to get belted around a bit because he deserved it, but for the adult to get belted around a bit, he got to go to jail. The person who did it's got to go to jail, even if the person deserved it, so-called. So our concept is very, very flawed. Yeah.
Would you need to repent and also forgive for every single...
If you just hold a bit closer for everybody here. Yep.
Would you need to repent and forgive for every single act that you've perpetrated or has been perpetrated towards you?
Yes.
Every single act?
Yes.
Okay. All right. Okay. All right. Thanks.
Clear enough? Stephen.
So I was just wondering, I feel quite soft towards my parents, but I know I've got a lot of stored up rage towards them. So would that softness be my facade?
Yes. It's a facade they helped you create. Yes. Yep. Lena, thanks.
And if I feel guilty and pressured to repent towards my parents, how do I shift into feeling that I actually have to forgive?
Correct. These are good questions, aren't they? So most of us feel so much. So a lot of children feel so much guilt towards their parents that they think they've got to, that their parents have got to forgive them, the child. And obviously that's not right, because we've just drawn what the patterns are, where the damage came from, and we can see if we trace the damage back to its source, we can see that the persons who have all the red stuff, where the source of all the red stuff is, that's the persons who are going to have to be forgiven by us. And we can see that if they are demanding that we repent when actually they need to be forgiven by us, then we can see we've got an issue here that we've got to resolve, yeah? So these are all good questions. So let's go through some of them, shall we? And so let's have a look. Forgiveness relationships, let's first summarise them. So what's the definition of a forgiveness relationship? Now, I'm going to go through this pretty fast because I've already presented a lot of this on the board. A relationship with another person who caused our pain from God's perspective by being unloving to us during our childhood or any time in our later life. And by the way, this is unloving to us from God's perspective. You know what happens at the moment? Many of you think someone's being unloving towards you when all it is they're not meeting your addiction. All right? Now that, from God's perspective, is love, not unlove, not a lack of love, right? So this is from God's perspective, not from yours. And this is where it becomes difficult, because most of us don't have God's perspective. We only have our own. So let's go next. A relationship with another person who suppressed our pain from God's perspective by being unloving to us during our childhood or any time during later life. So the first point was about the creation of the pain. And the second point is about the attempted suppression of the pain. Now, if you think about it, most parents do both of those things. They first create the pain, and then when the child starts to act out the pain that it feels inside of itself, the parents are not happy with that. And what do? Then they take action to suppress the acting out of that pain. And that then causes additional damage to our soul that we're going to have to forgive our parents for. Does that make sense? It's Teresa?
What about in the case of, as an adult, someone suppresses you? You have to forgive them as well, even though you've got some culpability in there?
We'll get to that, but if I can just make a general comment. Who attracted that adult into that person's life?
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Right, so let's say in your case, who attracted your husband into your life?
I did.
You did?
Yes.
So anything your husband now does is partially your fault because you attracted him into your life. Yeah. Can you see that?
Yeah.
So can you really say, like, if you should forgive anybody, you need to forgive yourself for attracting him into your life rather than thinking that you have to forgive him for the treatment, because his treatment is actually an attraction that you've attracted in order to address some of these healed emotions that you're not addressing. You see, if you had forgiven your parents by the time you were five, would you have it attracted a man who does the things that he does to you?
No.
Would you have attracted him? No, you wouldn't have. You might have even known he was your soulmate, but you still would have gone, well, I'm just going to interact with you, love you, until the time you've dealt with all those things, then I'll have a relationship with you or whatever. Right, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
So can you see our culpability in the relationship? See, most of us don't see that. You know what we do instead? We go, that person was terrible relationship. I'll go and get another relationship, and you feel resentful and angry towards that person, not understanding that that person was a person you attracted, not understanding that you attracted them to deal with some soul-based damage that you had refused to that point to deal with. Otherwise, you wouldn't have attracted them.
So any damage you've attracted is something that you
since
still...
Since your childhood?
Yeah, yeah.
Is?
Is something that you still need to repent for.
Any damage you've attracted in relationships.
Yeah, because you've attracted that.
It's more likely going to be something you're going to have to repent for than something you're going to have to forgive of somebody else. Yes. Yeah. Any damage you've attracted in your adult life from other events, right, could have been caused by the choices of those people. So that's a different issue. So I'm talking about now your relationships specifically, right? And what I'm drawing is some analogies here so that to help you see that for the majority of us, we're refusing to forgive and we're refusing to repent for things that we did wrong. We're refusing to forgive others for what they did wrong, and we don't even know the difference half the time. That's part of our problem. We're trying to forgive people who we need to repent with. We're trying to repent with people, our parents generally, who we need to forgive. And that's, of course, not going to be real. It can't work that way. Right? Now, bear in mind, as with everything that I'm talking about, God assesses all of these things individually. So some people do damage to their parents. Like, for example, a person that gets so enraged with their parents and refuses to forgive their parents might finish up murdering their parents. Well, that certainly is damage to the parents, which that person will have to repent for. Does that make sense? But what I'm trying to draw here is some basic analogies for you to see where most of the work has to happen for the average person on the planet. Yep, Kara?
If you get enraged at your parents but you don't murder them, is that the same thing?
Well, if you feel so much rage that you feel like murdering them, it's almost the same thing, yes, from God's perspective.
Is there a line somewhere?
Of course, when you actually murder them, then you've done even more damage, and of course it's escalated damage. But remember, I said in the first century that even a man who looks at a woman as wanting a relationship with her commits adultery in his heart.
Yeah.
So where is the line?
Well, my confusion is really like...
Karen, where is the line? There is no line. It's a sliding scale of intensifying reasons, isn't it? If you say that's 100%, right, and this is zero, right, what's the worst possible thing you can imagine?
Yeah, murdering them, yeah.
Yes, yeah, that's not the worst thing I could imagine. That's not the worst thing that's ever happened. What's the worst thing somebody could do to you, do you think? If they just come along and shot you in the head, and then compare that with what other things they could do, and you'll start to get what I'm meaning. So, Kerry, if you just mic back.
A slow torture?
Yes, if you had a very slow torture over years, that would be terrible, wouldn't it? Where they just kept you alive over years and years and years and years, and they sexually and physically and violently tortured you over years and years and years, that would be like that would be right up here at 100%, wouldn't it, of harm going on for years and years and years. Whereas a murder might be right down here in comparison to that. And then having hatred towards the person might be here, right? And then just having a dislike of the person might be here. And then, do you see what I'm saying? It's a sliding scale of different things. And God knows the exact point where you are on every issue, every issue.
What about if you, in the past, wished somebody would die quickly?
Well, that's if this is murder, then wishing when someone would die very quickly is very close to that, isn't it? In terms of the sin.
Yep.
Okay. So God knows where all of these places are. Once you connect to repentance and forgiveness, God will show you where you are on every one of these subjects.
Yeah? Thank you.
I'm just thinking of most of my life I've been in denial of the anger I have at my mother, and now I'm start becoming aware of the anger I have at my mother.
Yeah.
And childhood anger is okay, but I don't think this is childhood anger.
Well, can we get to discussing the details of individual things? Like, one of the things when I start raising these issues is, like, I'm angry with my mother. Well, anger is the first step of forgiveness of your mother. Denial of anger is you're in no steps towards forgiveness of your mother. And then anger is the first step of forgiveness towards your mother. Does that make sense? That's the first emotion that you'll probably have to go through to forgive your mother. It's not the only one, because you can go through, you can have rage and rage and rage and rage, and you can choose to project that rage, or you can choose to feel it. So if you chose to feel it and you process through the rage, what would come up after that might be some other emotions towards your mother. Like, oh, I don't understand why she did it. I don't understand why she did it. So you might go through that emotion. Does that make sense? So, but many of these emotions are going to be involved in the process of forgiving your mother. Yeah. So anger towards your mother in the process of forgiveness, if it's truly felt by you alone, is much better than denial of the anger of your mother. Does that make sense? So if you look at reversing a problem, if this is you'd like to murder her, right, resentment, rage, hatred, all those kind of things, and we start sliding down, when you're just angry with her now, that's here. Does that make sense? But even murdering her, the feeling of murdering her, you wouldn't act upon it, but the feeling of it's there, you need to feel it, release it. Once you release it, you'll realize why. You get that? You'll realize why it's happening. Yep. And then as you feel that, you might feel afraid of your mother. You might feel the feeling of, why did she do it to me? Why did she hurt me? Why, you know? And as you're feeling all of these feelings, eventually you'll get down to the fact that you've got no more negative emotion about your mother. And then you've forgiven her. Does that make sense? So it's going to be an emotional process. If you can't cope with being emotionally overwhelmed, you're not even going to do anything about this. Forgiveness, repentance, you're not going to be able to do any of it if you can't allow yourself to be overwhelmed emotionally. So that's why I've talked to you about being overwhelmed emotionally so much, right? Yeah. And if you can't be honest with yourself, do you think you ever do this? You've got Buckley's are doing this if you can't be honest with yourself. And if you can't be honest about other people, are you ever going to do this? You're never going to forgive anybody if you can't be honest about what they've done. And you're never going to repent towards anybody unless you can honestly see what you've done to them. So truth is a big part of this, right? Let's keep going. A relationship with oneself where we purposefully or unknowingly chose to punish ourselves at the emotional request of others because of the pain or perceived pain others claimed we caused them. So this is a forgiveness relationship still, a relationship where with ourselves, so we need to forgive ourselves for taking actions where other people induced us to take that action because we believed them. And so we did what they said. And that caused harm to ourselves. We need to forgive ourselves for that. Okay. All these kinds of relationships usually begin before 7 years old in our childhood. Right. These are the kind of things that were done to us. Now, I can feel that you guys need a bit of a break to go to the toilet and stuff like that. We've got a lot more to talk about, so let's just finish it there for 5 or 10 minutes, shall we? Have a bit of a break, and then we'll get on to discussing things more.